faith is not by sight. Before I get into our message today, I just want to take just a brief moment to thank all of you who supported the Parkside Scholarship Breakfast yesterday and all the support you give us all year long. We gave away 20 grand to some great kids every year.
Our spouse.
Some of y'all might be uneducated enough to put your faith in me. Please don't do that. I love you too, but don't put your faith in me. I just might disagree with you. But we do put our faith in something, and we put our faith in that something that's going to take us forward and hold us up in our time of need. And if I ask someone who's a little more learned or someone who's read a little more, even then in any real teaching, they'll say, well, faith is what it says in Hebrews 11. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the substance of things that I already possess, and the realization of things yet seen. That's what they'll tell you. But I want you to know that faith in God is the substance of our total existence. And if we have faith as God, then we'll have the expression of God's truth. Faith is the foundation of every single thing that we do. Why Revelation chose this subject and why it's so important is because she knows the development of the faith faculty is the key to our spiritual realization. Ernest Holmes sums it all up when he puts it this way. He says, pure faith is a spiritual conviction. It is the acquiescence of the mind, the embodiment of an idea, the acceptance of a concept. If we believe that the Spirit is incarnated in us, can demonstrate, shall we be disturbed at what appears to contradict this? We shall often need to know that the truth which we announce is superior to the condition that we are to change. Ernest Holmes is telling us that our faith, our words based on that truth, has more power than the condition that you're facing. It has more power than the fear that you're feeling. It has more power than the disappointment that you've experienced. Jesus said, it is done unto us as we believe. He followed up by saying, according to our faith, it is done. He said this because he knew that faith is a deeper inner knowing that what we seek is already ours. Jesus spent his entire time on this plane healing and transforming by affirming the power and presence of God within him, to demonstrate to us that if we want to heal our lives, if we want to transform our situations, we must have that same faith in the power and presence of God in us. Faith is what gives us the ability to see our best when we are experiencing our worst. See, you don't need a lot of faith when you got a lot of money. You don't need a lot of faith when everybody you love loves you. You don't need a lot of faith when you're well and feeling fit and healthy and running 5 miles a day and doing everything physically you want to do. But when the money runs short, when nobody loves you, when your body is feeling the ails and aches of being here for a long time, that's when you need faith. That's when you need the understanding that God and you are of one accord, and if you know this, trust this, believe this, you can move through every circumstance and every condition. Revelation reminded us all last week that in times of discomfort, that is what causes you to give birth to a new idea of yourself. Yes. So don't shy away from those conditions when they come. Embrace them knowing that because of that condition, you are going to develop the spirit and the faith, the confidence and the knowing to move through it and come out with a testimony. Jesus, the Christ consciousness, he demonstrated a mindset. He demonstrated a mindset that we can call faith, that you need to overcome disease, discomfort, and death. Those who by faith embody his truth can heal others and themselves using the same power of God within them. There are many stories in this book that talk about faith and faith walks. I'm going to share a few of you, one from James, one from Acts, and we're going to conclude with one from Luke. In the book of James, 5th chapter, 14 through 16, it says, "And the prayer of faith shall heal the sick, and our Lord shall rise him up. And if he has committed sins, they shall be forgiven. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man is powerful." Some texts will say healeth much. What that scripture is telling us is the elders of the church, which are the directive powers of spirit within us, when they pour out spirit of love, which is the nature of Christ, your sickness, your sinful nature is forgiven. And a man who comes clean, a man who repents, a man who forgives himself and forgives others has the power to pray a powerful prayer of faith, and through that prayer, see results. Then Paul, y'all remember him, right? Paul in the book of Acts, 28:8, he says this. He said, "But the father of the publicans was sick with a fever and dysentery. So Paul went to where he was lying and prayed. And then he laid hands on him, and he was healed." Paul healed the governor of a city called Melita. Paul, who represents spiritual truth, laid that truth on him, laid the potential on him. He laid hands on him. He demonstrated by the unity of thought, you can bring joy to those who, from error, are being unbalanced. You see, when thoughts of separation are destroyed, that's when we can experience the sweetness and peace represented by Melita. The last one I want to share with you, which is our main text for today, is one that you're very familiar with. It's Luke chapter 7, verses 1 through 10. And it says this. It says, "When he had finished all those words in the hearing of the people, Jesus entered Capernaum. Now the servant of a centurion was seriously sick, one who was very dear to him, and he was near death. And when he heard about Jesus, he went to the Jewish elders and besought him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying, 'He is worthy to have this done for him, for he loves our people and has even built us a synagogue.' Jesus went with them. And when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent some of his friends to him. And he said, 'My Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. This is why I was not worthy to come to you. But just say a word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man under authority, and there are soldiers under my command. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. I say to another, come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it.' When Jesus heard these things, he was amazed at him, and he turned to the people who followed him. 'I say to you, not even in Israel have I found such a faith as this.' So those who were sent returned to the house, and they found the servant who was sick had been healed." The centurion asked Jesus to heal his servant. Now, this is one of those circumstances where you read scripture and you visualize the story of a man wanting someone to come and heal someone who he needed. But the story is really about you. All the people in this story are about an aspect of yourself. So the centurion asked Jesus to heal his servant. The centurion represents human will, whose body can no longer serve him. But when the human comes under divine will, then he's no longer sick. So the centurion asked the Christ to take control of his organisms, that he may control his soldiers, that he may control his body. He had faith in discovering his spiritual truth would heal his body. His faith in the word of truth healed what served him. See, your body is what serves you. It serves your mind. He accepted the word of Jesus as having authority over all spiritual things in the same way he had control over spiritual things. Ernest Holmes said the centurion had a mental equivalent. You see, he knew that in his world, he was king. He ruled the soldiers. He had control over all of the faculties of his physical body. And when he told them to go, they went. When he told them to come, they came. So he says, if I have control over the outside world, if my faith is that Jesus, the Christ consciousness, has complete dominance and control over the spiritual world, then I know when he says come, it'll come. When he says go, the sickness will go. Jesus knew that we have the same power he has, but that power goes unrecognized by most of us, or shall I say many of us. But like the centurion, we must have the faith to accept him. We must have the faith to be like him in order to heal our conditions. So that being true, then, why don't we all just move through life easy breezy and just heal ourselves whenever something happens? As Reverend Lisa mentioned to you last week, Mark 22:14 tells us why. Many are called, but few are chosen. But we know we don't want to just read that. We know that God is not selective with his blessing. So what it's telling us is that few choose to answer. So many of us, as Reverend Lisa reminded us, choose to worry and not pray versus pray and not worry. So you see, our faith walk is being defined for us, is being described for us by all of the events of what we call this Easter season. It is a point-by-point description of how you walk by faith and not by sight. It starts out with the season of Lent. Then you move into Passover. You celebrate Palm Sunday. You stand tall on Good Friday. And then you worship the Lord on Easter Sunday. All of those events are a roadmap to your spiritual freedom. But to get there, you must walk by faith and not by sight. Reverend Lisa told you that the stories in this book or any book are not stories about someone else. They're stories about you. So your spiritual journey begins in Lent. It begins with you attaining spiritual discipline. It begins with you spending 40 days of reflection, meditation, and fasting. We start our journey, we start our faith walk by training yourself to meditate and pray without ceasing. We refrain from physical pleasures and focus on our spiritual enhancements. You see, the number 40 represents the culmination of all spiritual, mental, and physical trials. It represents the passing of every test. Then we gain the strength to pass over. We develop the mental attitude to leave our physical enslavement and move to the promise of spiritual freedom. We loose ourselves from the control of our physical senses. We embrace the Christ consciousness and we leave Pharaoh, the sense consciousness, behind. Now we prepare to make our triumph return into the heart space where peace abides and truth is conceived on Palm Sunday. We prepare to overcome all of our afflictions, all of our grief, and all of our despair. We realize that the grace and goodness that comes from having a faith and understanding will demonstrate the mastery over our animal forces and declare your unlimited source of spiritual strength. It will allow the Christ consciousness to take control of your life and affirm his favor and blessing. Palm Sunday, that's the day when you enter into a consciousness that prepares you for your spiritual freedom. That's the day when you get rid of all your bargaining thoughts. That's the day when you refrain from a vision trap. That's the day when you regain your vision and imagination. That is the day when all your fears are replaced by a strong faith. That's when you, by faith, are able to face all the challenges that may come into your life. Now, Jesus had a whole bunch of challenges. Some of his own, and he dealt with all of yours. The Bible describes those challenges in many different ways. But there was a group of folk who happened to be in charge, or shall I say, large and in charge, during his time. And even though he was born into a family of knowledge that was on par, if not exceedingly more spiritually intellectual than anyone in any of these groups, he had issues with the way they treated you. He had issues with the messages that they were giving you. So he spoke out. He spoke truth. He let everybody know that what's for you in this world is up to what's within you, not the people who control what's around you. These people had names. The Essene, of which his father Joseph was one. These are people that have a consciousness of exclusion and separation. These are the highbrow folk. You know, I tell people all the time, you know, they talk about who the richest people in the world are. They talk about who's in control of this and who's in control of that. But the people who are really in control of what's going on, you don't know their names.
That's right.
You never heard of them.
That's right.
If you know that, if they're on the news, they ain't controlling much but the news.
Right.
Trust me.
Right.
That.
That's right.
So these Essene were these highbrow folks who had this consciousness of separation and exclusion. If you didn't look right, if you didn't smell right, if you didn't dress right, if you didn't represent what they thought you should represent, they would not allow you to sit with them in church. You see, they would send them away. You know, every once in a while, somebody from our community may walk through here. And sometimes we all think, oh, we need to get rid of this one. That's an Essene consciousness. Jesus said to them, he says, instead of putting them out, why don't you clean them up? And that's our job. Not to put them out.
That's right.
But to clean them up. The Essene didn't like that. So needless to say, Jesus was not one of their favorite people. Then there was the Sadducees. These were those folks who read everything. These are the rich folks you know. These are the ones you see on the news. They run everything, and they're wealthy. But they're not quite at the level of the Essene. But these folks were so engrossed in all they controlled and all their wealth, they doubted the existence of an eternal life. They're about getting theirs by the heel. So Jesus' entire teaching was contrary to what they lived for. They didn't like it either. And then there were the Pharisees. Those are those self-righteous folk. Those are those ones who had a lot of hypocrisy of religion. Those are the ones who had all the dogma and all the 613 laws and told you that you had to live by each and every one of them while they disobeyed the ones that were selectively for them.
Preach.
You know, it's that hypocrisy that surrounds what we do called teaching and preaching that keeps some of us from stepping up.
Preach.
Makes us feel bad. Don't it run in your mind?
Right.
I felt bad. That's why they called me Minister Jerrold. I didn't want to call me Reverend Jerrold because I didn't want to associate with them folk. But Dr. Ronnie said, let me tell you something. He said, you are who you are. You will represent your truth. Don't worry about the rest of it.
Right.
You do what God has given you to do.
Right.
So I don't need to let y'all call me Reverend Jerrold. But see, those They remind me of a story I told you before, so if you've heard it, you already know it. But for those of you who haven't heard it, I grew up, by the time I was 12 years old, we were at New Hope Baptist Church on Central Avenue, 57th, everybody knew about New Hope, right?
Right.
Reverend Barry. Well, Reverend Barry was on vacation. So they invited this great speaker in from down in the Bible Belt. You know, they had one of the big churches down in Louisville, Mississippi. I forget exactly where he was from. But he showed up, and the church was full, and everybody wanted to hear this preacher preach. And he gets up there, and he starts preaching against the ills of drinking, and imbibing in wine and whiskey. And you know how the preachers from the Bible Belt get, they get all they think he got to do in his little faith walk and just Holy Ghost dance. And by the way, jiggling and Holy Ghost dance to half pound of elf oil.
Thoughts of inadequacy, drowning yourself in the mistakes of your past.
You may have partaken of the unleavened bread at Passover, but instead of just tasting the bread, I want you to make sure you're doing all you can to pass over into a spiritual life free of physical maladies that are caused by your impure thoughts. And on Palm Sunday, it may be your tradition to eat a little lamb, some figs, or some cheese. But I want you to remember that maintaining the innocence and focusing on your spiritual, physical well-being, that and that alone will prepare you for to face every challenge and to be blessed in every condition. On Good Friday, you may have a tendency to enjoy a fish dinner or some fresh vegetables or even fast. But no, it's your ideas of abundance and peace and the ability to refrain from doing harm or retaliating from those who fight against you is what prepares you for your ultimate spiritual expression. And then we get to Easter. Now, I know on Easter y'all came here and spent a couple hours with Reverend Lisa, but most of your day was spent eating and drinking. And you did it without limits. Some of you still eat Easter dinner. But if everything that you ate last week and everything that you embody from this day forward results in the consumption of bread, results in the consumption of a spiritual substance of truth, which Scripture calls the body of Christ. And every time you take a little sip or a little nip, you're drinking the wine of the vitality of spirit that unites the soul and the body, which is known as the blood of Christ. Then you can eat and drink all that you want, because it's the complete and total embodiment of the Christ consciousness that makes your resurrection possible. If you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that will give you the blessed assurance to walk by faith and not by sight. So we start out maintaining or retaining our spiritual discipline. Life can be so easy if we stay focused, but the pleasures of life sometimes pull us this way or that way, and we forget to stay focused on our spiritual truth. And then we get into a position where we have to be faced with the actual challenges of life. So after we move into an area where they start coming at us, they start challenging us, all the problems that we thought we had gone through are still standing in our face. That's when we have to bear the cross. And when that cross is put on our human condition, we get bogged down. We get doubtful. We get fearful. But when you allow that cross to rest on your spiritual condition, all of a sudden, it becomes light, because you realize the power to move through it is within you. And that all you have to do is recognize your truth, allow God's will to be done in your life, move your fears and your doubts out of the way, and rise to a consciousness of purity and love. Then and only then your faith walk can be complete, because the last step you take will be to step into the seat at the right hand of the Father.
Yes.
You will be whole, you will be healed, you will be resurrected, you will have walked this life by faith and not by sight. God bless you.